announced that we have a number of speakers here. They need to make sure that they leave at the right time. So we have swapped the first talks. We're still working on getting the projector going, but the speaker wants to start anyway because they have to leave at 10 o'clock to the airport, which might mean that there are no questions for the first talk. So with that announcement, let's get started. This is the second talk in the program, and it's on potential heuristics for mining agent planning.
Okay, so sorry for not doing the projector, but I'll start with the introduction. So are we talking about what the potential heuristics are used for in contingent planning? So I'll start with some introduction on contingent planning. So basically what I'm going to be talking about is the deterministic case. So we have multiple agents planning for joint goals. The goals are public for all agents. They are cooperative, so they are trying to achieve the goals together. But still, they have some privacy concerns. So that means that they don't want to share all their problem description. They want to hide some part of the problem. So you can imagine, for example, some consortium of companies which are trying to solve or achieve their some common project. So they want to cooperate, but they don't want to share their internal processes and their private know-how. So it will be based on multi-agent strips. So it's a minimalistic extension of strips, or in our case, we use multi-relevant planning task formalism, which is structured for the agents. So we have each agent has some actions and some of the variables, and in particular, so each agent has its own description of the problem, which consists of a set of public variables, which are shared among the agents, a set of private variables, and their values, which are private for each agent. Then there's a set of public actions, which are known to the other agents, and they use some of the public variables. And then there's a set of private variables which are known only to the particular agent. So, in this sense, our disjoint, so each action belongs to one agent, it's either public or private, and the same goes for the variables. So, okay, still don't have the image, so it's starting to be a little bit of
in which each agent is searching its own actions,
it's working in synchronous and in parallel. And the states which are created using a combination are shared to the agents. So this is the way how the information is propagated to other agents. Now I will say a few words on how heuristics works in mutation in general. So the most simple case is that we have a projected heuristics, and those are heuristics computed on a projected problem. Okay, great. So I will just show you the problem so you can fix your maybe in 3 still better than nothing, right? So this is the problem you were trying to mention. The variables, the actions, and so on. Okay, so with the heuristic. So the predicted heuristic is a computed in a projected problem, which is basically view of one agent on the global problem. So it consists of the problem agent and projected public actions of the other agent. So in the case of unknown action, you can see that the public prediction, which is below, is restricted just to the public variable. So there's no preconditions, just one effect. And the result of this is that if you compute a heuristic, for example, the optimal heuristic, or as possible, admissible heuristic, from the point of view of track, you can see that only the one action is needed to solve the whole problem. So the heuristic estimate is just one. From the point of view of the plane, it's a little bit better, but still the part of the track is represented by just one action. The optimal global solution is the cost of 6, so you can see that the cost is underestimated quite a lot. And the problem is that the sum is better, but it is not admissible in general, because some actions would be used multiple times. For example, the wrong action at the end. So the pros of the predicted heuristic is that it's effective, there's no additional computation, no additional communication, preserves privacy, somehow maintains admissibility if you use maximum, not sum. The cons are that typically the cost is significantly underestimated, as we have seen, and the sum is not admissible. So another way how to solve the problem is to use a distributed heuristic. So that's basically a heuristic which is computed by all the agents or subset of the agents to estimate the global problem. So far there have been a number of heuristics. The ANCAP and PDBs are inadmissible. So the pros of this approach is that the estimates are correct. The cons is that it's computationally, communicationally intensive, so you need to apply some protocol to compute the heuristic distributively. And it's often hard to preserve privacy or to prove that the privacy was preserved and things like that. So what we propose is a third way. A third way is to have something we call agent additive heuristic. And that means that each agent computes its part separately, but then it can be summed up and still maintaining admissibility. So that's the goal what we are aiming for. And even better would be heuristic which we call agent agnostic, and it means that if agent applies its own action, it doesn't change, it changes only its part of the heuristic. It doesn't affect the parts of other agents. And it may affect the public part if it's a public action. So the pros of this approach would be that the estimates are better, or maybe even correct. It is effective as well as the projected heuristic because there is no additional computation or communication. It preserves privacy the same way, but it would maintain admissibility even using the sum. And the con is if there is such a heuristic. And it turns out that the potential heuristics which are introduced quite recently are a perfect fit for this idea. So what are potential heuristics? So potential heuristics assign numerical potentials to some features of states. And typically the features are facts, which means in our case assignment of a value to a variable. And the potential heuristic simply sums the potentials for the facts in the state. So it looks like this. And the potentials are typically computed using a linear program with constraints which ensure go potential is so related to just one variable and its value. So we can iterate the potential heuristic on the public part, summing the public variables, and the private part, summing private variables or potentials for the private variables of each agent. So together it looks like this. There's a public part and a private part for each agent, and together we can sum the values and obtain a global heuristic. And this heuristic is agent additive, because the potentials are independent. It is agent agnostic, because each action of some agent influences only the variables of that agent. It is a global heuristic, global estimate, and it is admissible. So, for our example, potentials look like this. Maybe that's interesting, for example, for the package being in C, which is the goal, potential is minus 4, so it's very low and things like that. So how does it look in work in the search itself? So the search starts with the initial state. Each agent has its own view on the initial state, so it has the public part, the truck knows this part of the truck, and it doesn't know this part of the plane. And similar for the plane, it knows the public part, it doesn't know the part of the truck, and it knows the part of the plane. So first what we need is to communicate the initial state heuristic. So we communicate the initial state heuristic for the private parts, and now the agent still, they don't know the private part because it's encrypted or hidden somehow. But they know the heuristic, and they can sum the heuristic values to obtain the global estimate. Now, when the plane uses its move action, it modifies the private part of the plane, this part, but it doesn't modify this part, so again, it can sum the heuristic to obtain the global estimate without any communication. The same also for the truck, for the load action, unloaded move action, so now we are getting closer to the goal, the heuristic is decreasing. Now when the truck uses a public action, it modifies both the public part and the private part, but still it doesn't touch the private part of the other agent. But as it is a public action, we need to communicate the state. So now the part of the truck is encrypted, the part of the plane is decrypted, but the heuristic still can be computed. Again, when the plane uses its own public action, it modifies the public part, its own private part, the private part of the truck still intact, and we can sum the numbers to obtain the global heuristic estimate. So the only communication is the communication which was there for the mutated distributed case start, which is sending the states. Okay, so the question is how to compute the potentials in this setting. So basically what we can use is some secure relative computation algorithm. There are examples of that by Mangasarian or Dryer and Kirkbaum. The basic principle is that the LP is solved by one of the agents. All the other agents encrypt their part using some random transformation. They send their part to the agent I. The agent I computes the encrypted LP. Then it sends the results to the other agent. They decrypt the solution and obtain the potential, so that's basic principle. Now, some evaluation of the approach. So here are results from a setting similar to the competition in distributed and remote agent planning. The distributed setting, so each agent is running on its own computer and communicating over the network. So what we can see, this is the potential heuristic, this is a projected element heuristic, and this is distributed element heuristic. So we can see that the potential heuristic is better, mostly because of the Boxberg domain, so it's not that kind of decisive. It is significantly better than the distributed one. But what is more important is that when we look on the results from the classical planning for the same heuristic, we can see that the Alcat heuristic is actually quite significantly better than most of the domains than the potential heuristic. But in the distributed setting, it is the other way around. And the reason is that here, that like happening, this particular variant of the potential heuristic is worse than the unplanned heuristic. The estimates are worse. But what we get here is that here we get global estimates for free. So we have the best possible estimates. Here we have global estimates, so there's no overhead, but the estimates are much worse. And here we have global estimates, but with overheads. And because it's communicating over the network, the communication is quite costly. So basically, that's why kind of we can the potential heuristic here is better than the unplanned heuristic. So the conclusion we can draw from this is that the use of this kind of additive and agnostic heuristic improves the performance of the distributed search, and the potential heuristic is a good candidate or good example of such heuristic. For future work, we'd like to use better optimization function for important features and some general approach to this idea of additive heuristics, which you might have seen yesterday in my workshop, so we can preliminary work on that. Okay, so if you have maybe one question.
Okay, so thank you very much. Okay, so we have time for one question.
It's not for each, it's for the whole private part. So there's one, this is one variable, this is another one variable, and this is for the whole private.
So it's one variable.
It's one variable. So it's basically the same as would be in the prediction if computing the maximum.
So thank you very much again, and extra strong applause. So that gets us to our second talk, which is actually the first one listed in the program, and it's on stronger privacy preserving protections for multi-agent planning.
Just a quick announcement, we've moved the schedule back by 10 minutes, so the copy break starts 10 minutes later, the next session starts 10 minutes later, you have to eat your lunch 10 minutes quicker.
Or to create a high level that can later be extended using private actions.
And perhaps the simplest thing that you could do for a projection is to take all the actions and the facts of the coding agent and all the public facts of everybody and the public actions of other agents. But when you look at the public actions of other agents, you need to ignore all their private preconditions. So here's an example. Let's assume that C is a logistics center. So agent J has a public action for loading a package onto one of its trucks, and it has two preconditions, one of them private, which is that the truck should be at the logistics center, so the location of the truck is private to that agent, and one is public, that the package should be at the logistics center. If we look at the projection, then this is what agent I sees. So agent I sees the action of agent J, but it only sees its public part, so it only knows about the precondition of the package having to be at that logistics. Let's also look at the unload action, which is also public, of course. So we can see that in this case, all the preconditions are private. The location of the truck and the fact that the package is on the truck, both are private to agent J. So the projection would have no precondition. Of course, this is a very bad approximation, because now agent I believes that agent J can put the package wherever, whenever it wants, without any precondition. Okay, so what we're suggesting in this paper is to create a stronger projection, something that renders us more information than this simple projection. And we're going to use it in a plan-first planning, which means that we're going to build a high-level public plan, and then fill in the gaps using private actions. And we're also going to define a new form of privacy and show that our stronger projection also maintains this new form of privacy. Okay, so what we care about is about private dependencies between public actions. What is a dependency? Intuitively, you have to execute one action before the other. You have to first load the package onto the truck before you can unload it. But this dependency is private because it depends on some private fact known only to that agent. Of course, public dependencies are known to everybody and you don't need to do anything about them. We only need to do stuff about the private. And our goal is to publish the dependencies without publishing the public, the private. So first we need to compute these private dependencies, and we use a simple form of regression. Regression is a standard technique where you apply an action backward. There's something special about our regression. Since we care only about private dependencies, we only regress the private facts. So public preconditions are fulfilled by other actions and we don't need to care about them. So let's look at the example. So again, we care about this unload action, and what we're going to regress are the preconditions of that action. So the preconditions are that the truck needs to be. So we're looking at this very simple example out there, where we have logistics centers A and C, and one private city B. So the truck needs to be at A, and the package needs to be on the truck in order for the truck to unload the package. Now we can regress this using three different actions. We can load the package at A, we can drive the truck from B to A, remember that we're applying the action backward, and we can load the package at C. So what will happen? If we just load the package at A, this has only a public precondition, and then we're good. There's nothing that needs to be done. So we mark that by a true div. On the other side, if we load the package at C, then we regress the formula and get that the truck needs to be at C, but the truck also needs to be at A. And of course, this is inconsistent, and the regression can stop with a false div. In the middle, we see that we apply the driving action from B to A. And there we also have some options. We can drive the truck back to A, we can drive the truck to B, or we can load the package at B. If we drive the truck to A, then we get the formula that is identical to the route. Since we don't want cycles, we're going to eliminate that as well and end up with another false node. If we look in the middle, then driving the truck from C to B, so the truck needs now to be at C. And now we can apply that load action that failed initially, and again get another true leaf. So we build this regression tree for every public action in order to identify these private dependencies.
Now we're going to create from the tree a set of projected actions. So the actions are going to capture the execution of some sequence of actions. For example, if we look at this branch corresponds to loading the package at C, then driving, I'm doing this bottom up, then driving from C to B, then from B to A, and then we have all the preconditions that allow us to unload the package. So we care only about branches that end with a true node, that is, that give you a correct regression. So how do we create those projected actions? We add new facts. These facts denote the execution of an action. So we have one such fact for each public action in the original domain. And now the way we create the action is that we take branch, and again, we care only about branches that end with a true node, and we create one action per branch. Within that branch, we care only about the public action. The private actions are not important because they are all their preconditions in effect are already consumed. So the preconditions of the new action, of the new projected actions, those are going to be first the public preconditions of the original action, plus the facts that denote the execution of the public action within the branch. The effects are going to be that this public action was just executed, the public effects of that action, and also if that action destroys one of the actions that it relies upon, then it is as if that action wasn't executed. Here's an example. So we're looking again at the branch that ends up in A, okay? And we create an action for it. So the precondition, we only care about the public action, so the precondition is only that the node action, which is the only public action here, has been executed, so that's the F node. And also the public precondition of arrow, which is that the package So that's one. There's no public recognition there. The effect is going to be that the package is now at A, that's the effect of unloading, and also that the unload action has just been executed. And also, since we've ruined the private factor, the package is on the track, so now it is as if the load package was not executed. Okay, so this is the projection, and now we're going to use it. How are we going to use it? So each agent is now going to create a projection and send the projection to everybody else. Now we're going to collect all the agent projection and get a joint projection. And we're going to plan centrally over that projection, getting a high-level plan consisting only of public actions. And our agent will extend this plan using their private actions. And again, I'm comparing to other planners over the competition from last year, and as you can see, it has very good coverage, perhaps the best among all current planners. And I'm not going to go into that. Okay, so I suggested a new projection, and one may ask whether that new projection reveals more information than other projections. So to illustrate that, let's think about another projection. Let's call it the complete projection. In this projection, all agents are going to send all the private facts and all the private actions to everybody. So they're going to reveal all the private information and all other agents. Of course, this is an excellent projection, right? It has very good capabilities in finding the right solution. What about privacy? So one may claim that you maintain privacy through obfuscation, that is, instead of sending the actual private fact, I'm going to change its name to some maybe local identifier. And perhaps that way I'm preserving my privacy. And what we want to show is that at least there is some criteria that, some privacy criteria that this complete projection does not support. So when we talk about privacy models, there are generally two types of privacy models that people discuss. One is called weak privacy, where agent never published the actual value of the fact or the name of the private fact. And the strong privacy, where agents are unable to even deduce whether other agents have any private fact. Strong privacy might be a little bit too strong, and so we would like something in between. What we suggest is a form of privacy which we call cardinality privacy. So many DLTP objects have types, and what we would like to do is to hide the number of objects of a given type. For example, it might be that the argument wants to hide the number of faces, and the caterer might want to hide the number of trucks. So even if you know that I have trucks and that I'm loading and unloading packages, you will never know how many trucks do I have or how many private places do I go. One observation is that these private types cannot participate in public action. So even in this simple projection, where I'm just sending you actions, my public actions, where you just see my public actions, if you know that I have three unload actions in the same location, then obviously I have three tracks for three different unload actions. So these private types cannot be a part of any public action. So we have proven in the paper that our new projection maintains cardinality privacy. I'll just give you the intuition. So consider the two cases above, that the left is the actual world, and the right is a world where you don't know how many cities are in between A and C. So what would happen if you have more cities between A and C? So the truck would go back and forth and back and forth, and it can travel all the world. But eventually it will get to C, and there it will load the packet. It doesn't matter how many cities it has driven in between, because these are private actions. So what we're going to publish eventually are the same set of projected actions, actions that correspond only to the public actions along that. So this is the intuition. I'm not going to go more. And one problem is that when you plan, when you do the high level planning, of course, our projection is still an approximation, it's still inexact. And so what might happen is that you manage to compute a high-level plan, but it doesn't work in practice. That is, the agents are unable to extend it using their private action. And in that case, the fact that your high-level plan failed does reveal some private information. So the projection is preserve the cardinality privacy, but the planning process is gone. Okay, to conclude, so we have shown a new projection method, and we have shown that it is very useful in a new planner, and that plans for high-level public action and public plan, and then adds the private action. And we've also given a new definition of privacy. For the future, we'd like to show that our projection does hold some formal properties such as soundness and completeness. In fact, it is not quite clear what the soundness and completeness means in the case of projection. So this is something that we need to work out. And we would also like to use the projection in other planners. For example, Secure Maps is a planner that supports strong privacy. Perhaps if we combine the projection and Secure Maps, we would still get a planner that preserves cardinality privacy. And it is not quite clear how to use this projection as a heuristic. There are different ways that you can do it. And we're exploring that right now. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Are there any questions?
Well, let me get started. So I can imagine that for some objects I do worry about cardinality privacy, and maybe for others I do not. So it's a sort of a way of sort of some methodology that distinguishes that can deal with that.
So the thing is that there are some things that you couldn't hide. That's what I was trying to explain with the virus unload. So if I publish the unload, then you know that I have three tracks, right? So if there's something that you care about, you may need to change your model description. So perhaps the unload wouldn't have a track. So yes, you do need to think about the stuff that you want to hide, and you need to modify your definition of the word so that these things will get hidden.
Okay, any other questions?
Thank you very much again.
So in the interest of saving time, I'm going to stay here for the second talk. And so I'm now going to talk about macro generation in the same setting, which is great because I don't have to explain to you what privacy presents. skip that. I'm going to still work with a logistic example. It is very convenient for showing by its name. This one is slightly different. Again, we have here two agents. One of them, you can see this based on colors. And now the black circles denote the logistic centers. Now the dotted line denotes a bridge. And the truck cannot drive on the bridge if it's loaded. So it can only drive on the bridge when it's not loaded. The bridge is not very small. So if the agent wants to bring a D1 to C, even though it can drive on the bridge, it better to move the package to agent 2, and then agent 2 will bring it to 3, and then it can go to C. Okay, great, we can skip that as well. But now we're talking about a different algorithm. It's called the MAPS algorithm. It does heuristic forward search, where each agent independently runs the heuristic search. And every time an agent applies a public action, it needs to send the resulting state to another agent. So every time we achieve a new public fact, we notify the other agents that we have achieved it. So let's look at the example. Again, what we want to do is bring the package to C. So it goes like that. Agent 1 begins by loading the package on the truck, and then driving to A, and then unloading package at A. Unload is a public action. So now it needs to tell the other agent that the package is at A. And so it sends that state to agent 2. Agent 2 now can load the package on its own track, drive to 4, drive to B, unload it there. And then since this is another public fact, it sends it back to agent 1. Agent 1 now can drive back from A to 1, drive from 1 to 3, drive from 3 to B, and then load the package. Then drive back to 3 to C, unload the package, and then move that. So the agent have notified each other each time they achieve the new public file. And in this process, there may be some planning competitions. Let me give you an example. So now we have two packages and another agent. And let's assume that the packages, both packages need to be at B. So again, agent 1 would plan to bring the package to A, and agent 3 would also plan to bring its package to A. So we know how to bring package one way and how to bring package two way, and now they're going to send these public states to everybody else. So agent 2 now gets news to two new states. One where B1 is at A, and another where B2 is at A. And it can continue planning from both states. But the thing is that it never gets a state where both packages are at A. So if it wants to achieve the goal that both packages are at B, then it is impossible. What would happen is that the agent would send everybody the new public package. So now agent 1 also knows that package 2 can be at A, and it can start planning again. Now we plan again to bring package 1 to A. So this is something that he has already planned for, and now he's going to plan for again, just in order to get the state where both packages are at A. So this is a repeated planning process, and the new state is getting sent to agent 2. Agent 3 will do the same and send the state to agent 2. And now agent 2 has states where both packages are there, and it can load them both and bring them both to B. So these are planning repetitions, and we want to avoid them. And we suggest to avoid using the macro concept. So macro is a well-known concept where you have a sequence of actions, a valid sequence of actions, and you create a new action that represents the entire execution of this sequence. And the preconditions of the macro are going to be the all the preconditions of the actions in the sequence, and the effects are going to be all the effects except for the one that are destroyed. A well-known problem when you add macros is known as the utility problem. So macros can help you in advancing faster through the search process, because with the application of a single action, you in fact apply a sequence of actions. So this is good. But on the other hand, if you add too many macros, then your branching factor grows, and then your search process may slow down too much. So we need to balance. We need to find useful macros and add only them to the There are a few different ways to generate backlog. The first is known as offline. So in offline, you just see the domain and maybe in previous examples. So this happens before the planning process. You build a set of macros, and then when you get a new problem, you apply those macros that you've learned. A second approach is called semi-online. So now, during planning, you first get the problem, then you analyze the problem and identify macros, and then you run your search process. And the third approach is an online approach, where you generate macros throughout the search. So whenever during the search you find something useful, use that as a macro. And a little bit surprisingly, this wasn't very this wasn't used very much in planning up until now. But for us, in the setting of a privacy-preserving multi-agent planning, this is very, very natural to identify new macros. Essentially, a macro appears every time you use the public action. And the macro is going to consist of all the private actions that preceded that public action. So again, we have a macro for bringing package 2 to a logistics center A. It is just a set of private actions that preceded the public action of unloading. So this is very, very natural to identify macros this way. Okay, again the example. So again, agent 1 plans to bring the package to A and creates a macro. Agent 2 plans to bring P2 to A and creates a macro. Now they're going to send the states, and they're going to send the states, as we've seen before, to each other. Now agent 1 works on the state that it got from agent 3, where the package is already at A. But instead of having to again plan for bringing the package 1 to A, it just applies the macro. Same goes for agent 3, and they send their modified state to agent 2. Okay, now continue programming. So we avoided the problem of repeated planning to achieve something that we've already achieved before. Now, what I've just shown you is we call private macros, where each agent computes macros and maintains them locally. Another option would be for agent to compute macros and then send the macros to other agents while encrypting whatever needs to be encrypted. So let's look at the example like that. So now again, the agents compute the macros, and now they send the state and the macro to the other agent. So what happens now is when agent 2 receives a state where only one package is at that specific at A, it can also apply the macro of agent 1 itself. So it can apply the macro of agent 1 that brings and the package to A. So this is as if agent 2 is simulating the planning process of agent 1. So now we reduce the number of messages, because instead of agent 1 reapplying the macro and resending, agent 2 can do all the work. And what is kind of surprising is that one may think that sending out macros actually reveals information, but in fact it allows us to support what is known as strong privacy, as I explained in the previous talk. Because it allows us to avoid resending states again and again. I'm not going to go into details, but if you're interested, the details are in the video. Okay, some results. So I'm comparing maps with no macro, maps with private macros, and maps with public macros. It's quite obvious that in terms of messages, that's the bottom table, public macros help you a lot. And this is obvious, as I'm explaining. Allows agents not to send states back and forth, but to simulate the planning process of others. In terms of time, the results are less inclusive. In some cases, private macros are better. In other, not using macros at all is beneficial. But keep in mind that we are in a distributed setting, and caring about the number of messages is important. A little bit about the macro. So the macro I use a lot during the search. The public macros are used even more. If you look at the right column, this is the number of macros applied per state. So the macros do get used throughout the search. If we look at the final plans, so again we care about the right column, the portion, then we see that the macros account for a pretty significant percentage of the number of actions in the final plan. So these macros were indeed useful. They did get into the final plan. Okay, that's it in blue. I've shown you that online macro generation is quite natural in maths. It is done whenever you execute a public action. And what happens is that you add macros that seem useful because they have been found throughout the search process. For the utility problem, again, the number of generated macros is not very high. In fact, it's less than the number of actions in the domain. And we do generate useful macros because they appear in the final plan. They reduce the number of planning repetitions. And the interesting stuff that I showed you about the public macros, the fact that you send macros actually allows you to support strong privacy. In the future, we'd like to apply macros in other algorithms and also combine macros in some search space. That's it.
Are there any questions? So, I guess I started. Can you see more about your experimental results? In some cases, public Microsoft and private Microsoft, and in some cases, they didn't.
So, again, in terms of what? In terms of messages, macros always help you. Sometimes the public macros, almost always the public macros are best in terms of messages. And you do care about messages because when we run the experiment, we run them locally on a single machine and we don't actually send anything out. So the time results are kind of a little bit unrealistic. Practice, when you really send out messages, then you expect the process to be much slower. I think that it was shown in the actual condition. So I think the markers are always beneficial in terms of messages, and this is important. And they are almost always also beneficial in terms of right. And yes, it is kind of inconclusive about which one is better in terms of time, private versus public. But again, if public allows you to support stronger privacy, I think that's also a good argument.
Any other questions?
Thank you very much.
Misses the ball, knows it can shoot, but is not well positioned, misses the ball, green lands fast, and eventually shoots. So what happens here is that indeed we have this problem of adversaries. So first we have to understand how do we learn in the presence of adversaries, how do we plan to really do better in these adversaries. So I'm going to, in this paper, focus on only one problem, the free kick problem. So why do we do this learning for free kicks? And eventually then explain it as how we learn to do this selection of different free kicks and give experimental results. So the motivation for this actually need for adapting to the opponent is that, interestingly, even if we won all the games, and in round robin one, round robin two, quarterfinals, finals, the performance of success is quite different. So we have a planning strategy that takes into account opponents eventually, but magically, it's still the case that even if we take them into account, the performance is very difficult. So we would like, we find that these planning is something you do up front, the modeling, which is what we are using now, inevitably needs to have some online adaptation. What are the difficulties of online learning, online adaptation, the reinforcement learning a nightmare on real games? First of all, is that it's a very large planning space. It's highly dimensional. If we take into account the position of all the robots, if you take into account everything you can observe, it's very, it's also partially observable because we don't know where they are going, the opponents. There is a lot of delayed reward, in the sense that we make choices that end up in a goal milliseconds, seconds later, so there's this problem. And then there's also very sparse observations, because a game, even if it's 20 minutes, it only allows like 40 passes, and maybe 25 shots at the goal, and 15 free kicks, so we struggle, from a research point of view, about this, how do we do online learning in these situations? And now, actually, just to tell you, just as an example, we are actually trying to do deep reinforcement learning now in millions of games in simulation that maybe will cover these types of problems, like in the example of AlphaGo. Now we have to solve the problem of all the representation of everything, but ideally, you could like use an enormous amount of data to eventually cover these problems that we have on online. So that would be the hope, but let's see. But let me just delve in how we did this. So the online for free kick plans, why focus on free kicks? Free kicks means that, I did not know this term in English either, but free kicks in a game of soccer means that the ball is stopped, like the ball went out or there's a foul or something, so the ball stops, which is a great advantage because you can position your players wherever you want. So you can have these different free kick positions. Here's an example of a free kick in which our robots are positioned in like all they are ready, the four of them, and eventually then you can apply some strategies, kind of like these predefined things, perfect for planning. So we're going to just explain this approach, how do we do these learning from sparse observations. First we have to reduce this planning space, and then we have to eliminate this delay of reward one way or another, and then we have to find out which online algorithms. So the contribution of the paper is in fact explaining how we handle this problem with these three steps. And so first we're going to explain how we do this as a bandit problem, and we literally reduce the space of the game by the planning space by saying the ball is in 2D, which is not true, because there are chip kicks, and we also unfortunately project them into the field and use for the learning as if the ball was a ground kick, which has made our robots make very wrong decisions. So this is a very unfortunate reduction in space, and in no way can we look at the 3D space just because of a few chip kicks. I'll give you an example very, very fast. We had a goal scored on us long ago, or last year, because this predictor sees the ball in chip kick and thinks that the planner that the when the ball is on top of the robot, it's 3D, but it's on top from a vision, from a 2D point of view, thinks the robot has possession of the ball. And it doesn't. The ball is just over it. And it acts as if the robot is in possession of the ball, moves to try to grab the ball, and we don't have sensors necessarily actively, and it opens the shot because it's just thing. So this is like an example of like, what a nightmare. Just to produce a 3D to 2D, you lose such a bad abstraction. And then the robots being our robots having been controlled by our initial conditions defined, the opponent is offline. It's the ball that's a problem. So let me just say how we further reduce the planning space. We created two-step free kick plans, basically just a bunch of conditions under which all the robots were here in some initial position and some final position, and these particular locations are predefined. We have exactly the robots in some initial positions, and we literally say the next step blindly is the next one, the next final position, and we would like to know if that is right. And eventually the robots score like that. So this is important. So we still have 12 continuous space problem because we have 12 robots on the field, but it's better than nothing. And so finally, for reducing the planning space, we did one step more, which meant that we created 6 specific tricky configurations. And I have not have time to explain that you guys know much more about soccer than I do, but eventually it's like you are in a position such that all of them are passable with different levels of time to shoot, and then others that are very central, others that, this is a very beautiful one, we love this one because by positioning them there, we coerce the opponents to go there. They all think they're going to pass to those, but there is no intention of passing to those. And then there is one that comes out of nowhere from the defense and boom, just scores. So this is a very beautiful free kick, very deceiving for the opponent. And then the next one is similar, but actually the ball is on a different position and comes from the side. It's more angle rather than time. And then eventually also we have others in which it's a lot of, and this also is very beautiful, I like the last one very much, which is the angle one. So we position 3 of us here and the 4th one there, going there. And what happens is that a computer that will compute which one out of these 4 is the most likely to score based on an angle, the open angle of these is much bigger than that one, which is a very, 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 very narrow shot. And so the opponents tend to block this instead of that, and we are going to pass to the one that has really the smaller angle, but eventually the opponents, if they use an angle computation, are not going to mark that one. Anyway, 6 plays, and then the whole paradigm became how do you go about, how do we go about doing this? When do you choose which one? This problem of actually planning, even that you have 6 fixed choices, 2-step, how do you go about choosing them? And this is a problem in which we have and also for the choices, a better problem, you would have to say which reward. And I mean, long ago, even like from my first student's thesis, Peter Stone, this reward problem is a nightmare because we can decide when. Is it like losing ball possession immediately? Is the ball going out? Is scoring a goal? So we actually have again to take a function of this reward and saying that if you score a goal within 10 seconds, you get reward 1, and if you don't score a goal, you get reward 0. So one thing I want to tell you, so these are the parameters. And unfortunately, we have not done enough kind of learning and so forth to play with all these problems. What about if it were 8 seconds? What about if it were like 20 seconds? What about if we have 4, reward 1, 0.5, minus 1, 0? Magic. I don't know. Hopefully, it would not have as much as impact, but I don't know. So finally, let me explain the algorithm itself, which is the interesting thing here. So the algorithm is actually based on these model expected reward function with Gaussian processes. The Gaussian processes are very useful for the actual online learning, because the adoption process, the examples are coming as we go. And the beautiful thing about the adoption process is, like, if you actually get all these points, this picture is not, it's taken from the web, maybe you probably have seen this in many talks, but it's a picture that is really beautiful, which is the following. If you look at the little crosses, if you don't see them, there are crosses here. These are the data that was accumulated. But this, and you are trying to predict some function, which is this blue line. But the part of the blue line prediction that has very few crosses has a much higher variance, which means that I don't know as much about the zone of the space. And so this is the secret of these upper confidence behind algorithm with neural learning, is because when you are going to sample, when you are going to select actions, in some sense, if you select actions here, you are exploiting. If you are selecting actions there, you are exploring much more. So this is the beautiful thing about the online learning and planning, is because you discussion process with this UCD kind of like confidence now enables you to come up with this. So how does this work? Very fast. So basically we create the Gaussian process that when you get examples, a few examples in simulation or really during the whole game, you start building the Gaussian process. It's symmetric, so we always show that on one side, but that's where that comes from. And this thing here enables you to give it some state and some action. You can compute an estimate of the reward of that action. It's an estimate. Even if you have all of these points, you approximate by a Gaussian, you pick any other point here, and the Gaussian process gives you a number based on the data you have. And then we do the selection of actions using the UCB algorithm, which is very interesting from a planning point of view, and this is dear to my heart because, whether you know or not, I did plan reuse, probabilistic plan reuse with Daniel Bozzato, with Fernando Fernandez, with Philippe Trazet-Vizan, in which it's always like this. The science of planning and execution, and the conditions where the models are poor, are always to exploit something, but also to explore. So you have to do something random from time to time, and we apply that kind of like a randomness based on the deviation of the Gaussian process, and of course with some parameter. But basically, if you have samples of this type, if this is your current mean is of this sort, if this is your current variance, and applied with some delta, you end up selecting actions according to this gray and white area, which magically you get all this thing and tells you where you should select the next action. Okay, so the algorithm is just to call this UCB computation to select actions, which are these three kicks, six out of the three kicks, and you give it one more residual, you add one more point, and the Gaussian process is getting better. So in the experimental results, to finish, I'm just going to explain that we did win all these games, and I can brag as much as I want because it actually happened. And even in practice games, 5-8-0, 10-0, 6-0, 10-0, everything was won every day. We had a lot of like, success in the passes, but there's this, the nightmare of submitting papers to a conference. People are always going to say, yeah, you won, but they won. It was 7 days, it was 10 days. It's so hard to evaluate. And moreover, it's also hard to, I mean, we did win, and no matter what, the reviewers always say, oh, okay, do more games. Where? How? It's like a nightmare, right? The guys next door, when they AlphaGo beats the other guy in 5 days, they get all the credit. In Robot Cup, when we get like beat someone in 6 days, oh yeah, do more games. I mean, it's not fair. But anyway, I'm just saying that this is for us also, honestly, scientifically, you know what the problem is? You would like to say like this, so when we have this freaking kind of learning, what if we did not use it? Would we have lost? The problem that the ground proof, the problem that we actually don't know, and if we win, was it because of this? We have so many things there that could be responsible for the win. How do we go out of this ablation study? Turn off, like learning free kicks. Turn off strategies about evaluation blue box. Play So we did a lot by an experimental procedure. Now it's again, has flaws, because what did we do? We created three fake opponent teams with problems. Doesn't matter what, much that we try to compute all time defense, angle defense, and the combination. So these are fake teams. Fake teams, they're not the real ones. But of course, we try to make them as real as possible, and then we evaluated with respect to the one more thing. We actually, these fake teams and our six strategies, we did the ground truth. We exhaustively ran thousands and thousands and thousands of games till we actually could compute a good estimate of the real reward, so we could do regret computation. We don't always probably evaluate something. And eventually this is like the ground truth, the expected reward is only means like the actual values numbers. And another thing I want to tell you about is, look at the trouble we go to be able to compute regret, to say that in fact the optimal action would have been whatever what. My algorithm is selecting something, so we have a value of regret, and we have a value of the best action, and then we can show the results that everybody's happy. Yeah, that's really well. So this means that the great thing is the optimal reward according to the real ground truth, and the blue thing is our algorithm applying these Gaussian processes, selecting a particular kickoff, a free kick, out of the six, in the presence of teams that are defense driven, only time difference different, that they only take into account the time that the opponents do, the angle, and the combined defense. So that we see that we can actually approximate the chosen reward. We are not doing optimally, but it's still to 100 games to play. But we are happy that even at the beginning, with this type of algorithm, we are doing well. So we are confident. The only thing I want to tell you about is always probable for you to for us to actually look at the beginning of this and see that for this particular time defense approach, we would do well even with few examples. Here, it took much longer to approximate the optimal. So in our next RoboCup, we are going to do free kick adaptation using a lot of these time defense kind of ideas, because eventually that seems to be closer to optimal than before. So in conclusion, so I'm just telling you that it's very beautiful to do planning, but in the presence of opponents or poorly modeled things, you have to do online learning, inevitably. And to do online learning, we have to know how to accumulate data in Gaussian processes, how to select data from these probabilistic models, and eventually how to have a way to evaluate whether we are doing good or bad. Thank you very much.
Are there any questions?
Yes.
Thank you for the nice talk. I would
thanks. I would ask whether even if I know it's not, let's say, so common that teams are deploying dynamic strategy, but the idea of extending your approach, considering modification of the strategy of the opponent, and so to extend your approach with this kind of information.
Exactly. So this is the nightmare also, right? Because we are assuming they are applying the same strategy. One day, when we've all been learning, then we are pure game theory in the physical space, and maybe there's an action equilibrium that we'll converge to, I don't know. Even currently, even if they are applying the same strategy, which we actually believe that all the teams have a fixed kind of complex, half a million lines of code, I don't know how much thing, very complex, but still is not adapting during the game. We are the only people that adapt these free kicks as we play a game. We don't think they are adapting. But you are absolutely right. 10 years from now, I might be giving a talk. We are all learning. Okay, well, 0-0. Welcome to the human soccer. Or something like this. See that? Okay.
May I have a bit naive about the recent development on the football with robots, but am I right in saying that you are trying to reinsert a playing schema and then have having clearly to cope with the variability around time, because, and you have strategy for adapting quickly. I'm right in saying that you are more or less saying this, then I have a joke for later.
It's a very good question. The AAA paper, for example, mentions what we do with game on, which is much harder. But the free kicks, you know, the free kicks, it's like as we stop, so we can actually position ourselves, and they also can do whatever we want, and we observe what they've done. So the kind of like stopping the game is an advantage for learning, and therefore that's what we are trying to build upon. And maybe this year, in the game, instead of having 6 free kicks, we might have only 2. Because maybe we will have a better chance to learn. But magically, these free kicks, if they are not addressing a flaw of the opponent, if they don't counter a flaw of the opponent, they are no good. So when we try to come up with these free kicks, is to try to come up. If they would only take into account angle, then we would defeat them with this plot. If they would only take into account time to get to the goal, then we would defeat them with this play because we bring the one all the way from the back. If this, so we are considering what kind of like defenses they could be doing on our free kicks and try to have specific plays as a response to that. It's almost as if sometimes I think about the planning competition and so forth. It would be very nice to think of following, and I'm challenging you that I don't come all the time to ICAP, but I love planning. I do. This is like, well, my students say I'm obsessed with planning, it's true. But what if you guys in the planning competition do like this? Suppose that instead of having these random problems you all face, suppose that you don't know which types of planning problems there will be there, but they are of a particular kind. Suppose that you now fake problems in which the logistics domain, all the objects are inside already at an airport, or all the objects are already in this location. Create situations in which these random problems challenge your ability of taking advantage of that specific structure of these problems. The random thing is kind of the least interesting thing, because neither at first, Federal Express, when I did logistics domain in 1986, we interviewed Federal Express, and Federal Express does not assume that the initial state is all random. They know that at Thanksgiving, everything, all the packages go to Florida, that's it. They know all these patterns of input that they need to address. They do not assume random initial states. And it would be very nice one day to have these different types of initial states, these different types of structure, and see who can take advantage of that structure in real time. No random problems. In anything, logistics is an example that's very realistic, but also elevators and whatever. All your planning competition should be about not having random problems. This is my call to reality. Thanks a lot.